in Hebrew, each letter has a meaning. So the first letter, Aleph, means leader. And Bet, their equivalent of B, means house. If you put those together, you have the leader of the house. That's the word for father, Ab. Then if you take the word, the letter He, it's the essence. If you put it in the middle of the word, it's the essence of that word. So Aleph, He, Bet becomes the essence of the father, Ahab. And that's the word for love. So I thought I'd share that with you. The father's duty is to love. Amen. Let's stand as we let's stand as we sing.
Great are you, Lord. shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Is more. matter the circumstances that you're in this morning, whether your father is here or your father is away or your father is already home, we are never fatherless. We have the best father of all in our God. He is the father of all. I know I don't surprise you. You've known me from the start. My failures and successes, well, Lord, you've seen them all. With all my resolutions, still I stumble now and then, but you've remained just like you've always been. When I'm in need, my counselor, Lord, you are wonderful. Patient, loving Father to me. In a world lost in uncertainty, I know you will always be an ever faithful Father, an ever faithful Father to me. And like the child who reaches for things best left alone, and learns too late, the Father really knew best all along. You held my hand in sorrow, Lord, you helped me to believe. You gently promised you would always be.
Mercy and love. In a
Thank you, Sandy. Ever faithful Father, that's for sure. So today we are going to continue in our series in 1 John. We're going to be in 1 John chapter 3. And, you know, every message is about the faithfulness of our Father in one way, shape, form, or another. And that's the way that it should be, right? That should be our focus in this building and outside of this building, that as we live our life, that we are out there telling people about the faithfulness of our Father and how that, you know, we talked about this last week, and I'm going to get back into it a little bit, but just to, you know, because I can't help myself. The faithfulness of our Father and how that, you know, our worth isn't found in the things offered of this world, but found in the faithfulness of our Father. The fact that, you know, Jesus came to die on the cross for our sins, and that's where our worth is found. But anyway, so we'll get to that as we go forward. But John here writes this epistle to the people in and around the city of Ephesus, where he's living at this time. And he lists in the book of the epistle of 1 John four different reasons why he's writing this message. And the first is that your joy may be full. And that's found in 1 John 1:4. And then in 1 John 2:1, he says that you sin not. And in 1 John 2:26, he says that you not fall prey to false teachers. Chapter 5, verse 13, he says that you may know that you have eternal life. So he's writing this letter to these people, and all of the content is structured around the fact that he wants these people to know, these Christians that are living together in community, attending church together, studying together, worshiping together. He wants their joy to be full. He wants them to remain sinless. He wants them not to fall prey to false teachers that are going around giving things that are not doctrinally sound, that were not what Jesus taught, that were not, you know, from the Word of God, and that they could know, that they would know Jesus Christ, and that they could know that through knowing Jesus Christ, that they would have eternal life with Him. There's a lot of different subject matters that he goes through, and we've talked about a lot of them already: love and light and knowledge and sin and fellowship and love, and John really hits on the love, and I don't know which one of you guys need it, but we're going to go with it again today. Love. Maybe it's me. We keep coming back to this subject of love. And when John is writing this, he's talking about that agape love, that love that we've talked about many times. How that, you know, the love with work boots on, the sacrificial kind of love that Jesus showed for us once again. And, you know, it's very appropriate on Father's Day to be talking about love, like Gary mentioned this morning. That's Father's job, right, is to love. And, you know, and I told Angie before that I would definitely get her crying before the end of the day. But for Father's Day, for me, it's a very appropriate subject, because that's one of the things that, you know, I was able to learn from my dad, is that sacrificial love. And it's good to have earthly fathers that give that example, right? And it's important. But if you didn't have a father like that, like Sandy talked about, you're never alone. You have always have a father that cares for you and that was willing to sacrifice for you in a real and important way. So we'll go ahead and we'll read 1 John 3. We'll read verses 10 through 18 to get started. In this, the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderers have eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso hath this world's good, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Let's go ahead and pray. We'll get started. Dear Father, Lord, I thank you for this passage. I thank you for John and his willingness to write the words that you laid upon his heart, Lord. I thank you for the teachings that you've given us, Lord, and that how badly we need them, how badly we need them to show the world of our love, Lord, that if we can't love each other in this building, that there's no way that we can show your love outside of this building, Lord. I just pray that you would convict the hearts of all those that hear your word, that if there's any here that needs you, that they would find you, Lord, and that they would come to you, Lord, and that they would see the need to have you in their life. I just pray that if there are any other decisions that need to be made this morning, that you would weigh upon the hearts of the people, Lord, that they wouldn't wait, that they would make the decisions that you would have for them to make, Lord. I just pray that as I bring the word that you've given to me this morning, that I would listen to you and that I would be empty of myself and that I would just say the words that you would have for me to say, Lord. I just pray that through all this, your name will be honored and glorified, Lord. We love you. Thank you. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. So 1 John chapter number 3, like I said, we've been talking a lot about love. And John is pretty clear here in this first verse that we talked about in verse number 10. He says, in this, the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil. There's two different ways that you're going to present yourself, that you are going to manifest yourself. Either a child of God or a child of the devil. That's really it. It seems kind of harsh. It seems kind of difficult. But this is the way that we are made known. And it says that whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. So if you are doing right, if you are acting rightly towards your brother, righteously, doing the things that God has told us to do, mainly in this passage, loving them, then you're going to be identified, you're going to be made known as a child of God. If you're not doing those things, if you are backbiting, if you are saying things that aren't true, if you're attacking people, if you're doing those things that are not right, then you will be manifest, you'll be made known by a child of the devil. So that's the first question for us today. Who do we look like? Who are we manifesting ourselves as? Now notice how John identifies love here. In society today, in the world, and in the world's view, love is an emotion that is, you know, subjective. It changes. It's something that you could feel, you could not feel, fall in love, fall out of love. But John says that loving is not just an emotion, a feeling that you have. Love is an action. He said love is doing right. Romans 13, if you want to flip over there, if not, you can just look at the board. Romans 13, verses 8 through 10. Owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet, and if there be any commandment, if it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is fulfilling the law. Paul, writing to the church here in Rome, and he's saying, listen, it's not difficult. And in the next verse, it says, John says, this isn't a new commandment. This is what you've heard from the beginning. The Ten Commandments here listed out, and then Paul just puts it all into a nutshell. That's great. Don't do any of those things. You all know these things that you're not supposed to be doing. But if you want to put it in a nutshell, look, I'm in a nutshell. Man, I thought I might get a little bit more of a laugh, but it's easily condensed as love thy neighbor. Love thy neighbor as thyself. Don't treat them bad. It's easy. I mean, it's not easy. It's simple, though. It's simple to comprehend what we're being told. It's not always easy to love each other, but that's what we're called to do. God gave those Ten Commandments a long time before Paul even wrote this part of Romans. And Paul reiterates it in him, do right. Do right. Live right. Love each other. Treat each other right. If we are going to be identified with God, if we are going to manifest ourselves as a child of God, we have to love sacrificially. It's the only way it's going to be known. If we are not loving sacrificially, by contrast, we're going to be manifested as a child of the devil. We're not going to be identified as a Christian. We're not going to be identified as someone that follows the Lord. Do we love our brothers and sisters? Are we working to help them? Do we work to edify them, to build them up, to encourage them, to strengthen them? Or are we harboring angry feelings? Are we attacking? Are we jealous? Are we doing all of the things that we know since we were a little kid that we were told not to do, but we still do it? How are we manifesting ourselves? For this is the message, verse 11, that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Leviticus 19, verse 18, God speaking to Moses to tell the children of Israel, thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. He said, listen, I'm the one that can tell you this. Listen. Love your neighbor as yourself. I don't know how many times I'm going to say it this morning. So it's going to eventually start sounding like a broken record. But John's saying the same thing over and over throughout this epistle. In the Gospel of John. You know, all the writers say it throughout the entire Bible. God says it. Jesus has said it. The Holy Spirit lays it upon your heart all the time. Love each other. It's not a difficult concept. John goes on in verse 12, not as Cain, who was manifested as a child of the devil, who was of the wicked one and slew his brother, and wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brother's righteous. We all know who Cain is, right? Let's go ahead and flip over to Genesis chapter 4 and we'll read verses 1 through 10. And we'll get an update on who Cain was and what he did. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. So taking a little pause here, Cain's mad, right? Cain gave his offering to the Lord. Abel gave his offering to the Lord. Abel's was accepted. Cain's wasn't accepted. And he was ticked off. He was mad. He was wroth, the Bible says. That's big mad in today's vernacular. Big mad. And why? Because he was jealous of his brother. He was upset that his brother, who was his younger brother, I mean, we all know like what that is like. Well, I don't have a younger brother, but we all know that concept, right? God loves him more. He was mad. And God gave him an opportunity here. God didn't just smite him down for his anger, punishing. He said, Cain, what are you doing? Why are you mad? You know all you have to do is do right. You know what I'm saying. This isn't confusing. Why are you acting like this? We've all said that to kids, right? Why? What in the world? Why are you doing this? Why are you acting like you're so angry? This is irrational behavior. What are you doing? All you have to do is do right. You don't have to do anything special. You don't have to do anything over and above. Just do what you know that needs to be done. Cain did not respond well. Verse 8. And Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel, thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth out unto me from the ground. What a horrible thing that his brother was able to do that day. God even gave him a chance, like I said. He tried to correct him. God corrects us all the time, right? That little Holy Spirit inside of us going, okay, what are you doing now and why are you doing it? Stop. Quit it. All you got to do is right. And you know what right is. I told you, love your brother. Are you loving your brother? Are you loving your sister? Are you treating them rightly? It's easy. Why are you? And we have that inside of us that stops us so nice. But it's really hard to get over jealousy sometimes, right? You know, we all know people like that are so good. They do everything right. They just get on your nerves. And sometimes you're just like, can you just do something wrong? Can you just not be nice all the time? I just want to complain and badmouth this person and be angry at this person, but you just won't let me do it. You keep bringing me back. Well, that's not what God says you should do. And sometimes you really want to punch those people in the face, right? Sometimes you really just don't want to hear it. Been there. But what are we called to do? Called to love them. Doesn't matter what they've said, what they've done, how they've treated us. No contingencies put on that. We're supposed to love them. Jealousy is a difficult thing to get over. But we have to. We have to get through these things. And we can only do it with the help of the Lord. Had Cain gone to God and said, you know what, God, you're right. You told me what my sacrifice should be. I messed up. Take a little bit of personal accountability on that. You know what? I did it wrong. I'm sorry. And all could have been well. But he didn't do that. He harbored those angry feelings. He kept them in his heart. So the next time he saw Abel, it wasn't, hey, brother, how you doing? It was, hey, punk, why does God like you more? And I'm sure it escalated from there, and we know how it ended. Verse 13 says, marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. Don't be surprised. The Bible talks about it all the time. You go through the passages there, and we want to believe as Christians, and there are teachers out there that want us to believe that if we do what we're supposed to do and we're following God, everything's going to work out for us, and everything's going to be great, and we're going to live this great life of hunky-doriness. The Bible's very opposite of that. If you do what God says, the world, the social structure that we abide in, that we live in on a day-to-day basis physically, is going to hate us. They're going to treat us poorly. They're not going to like the things that we do. And John's saying, don't be surprised by this. It's going to happen. They're not going to like you. But once again, where is your worth found? Do you care what the world thinks of you? Do you want the devil to be proud of you? Do you want the sin and evilness and all this? Is that what you want for your life? No. We can't. Our value is not in how people next to us treat us, people in the world treat us, even our fathers. I mean, it's tough when you have family members that treat you poorly. And I'm sure that there are people in here that experience this and have experienced it and do experience it. Thankfully, probably not my kids. But there are people. There are people all the time that experience this kind of dislike and hatred. And our value is not in that. Our value is in the fact that God cared about us so much that once again, he sent his son to die on the cross for us. He had his son come to be the propitiation. I really like that word. The propitiation for our sins, that which appeases, that takes care of the punishment that we are due so that we don't have to experience eternal separation. In fact, James says, count it all joy when you come through all this stuff. When you go through divers temptations, when you go through a multitude of different things, persecutions, things in your life that are difficult to deal with, when people are treating you badly, you should be happy about it because I must be doing what God wants me to do. Because when those things happen, James says, you're going to get more mature. You're going to get closer to God. It's going to be an experience in your life that makes you stronger. And you should be happy about that. That's what the Lord wants out of us, right? To be stronger, to be closer, to keep moving closer and closer to Him so that the world sees Him through us. Once again, all summed up in love. Verse 14, we know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. The death that John's talking about here is spiritual death, right? We're all going to experience physical death unless the Lord comes before we get there, which, you know, I would be fine with. But because I don't look forward to physical death, you know, I think that could be. And it's not actually the dying part that bothers me. I'm not afraid to die. I'm afraid of the pain that leads up to the death. So, but this death that John's talking about here is a spiritual death. A death that is separating us eternally from the love of Christ. From living with Jesus in heaven. That's the separation that he's talking, or that's that's what he's talking about here as far as death. He's talking about that death that we can't come back from. And notice that he doesn't say that love is the reason why you pass from death unto life. That's not how you get from eternal death to eternal life, right? Eternal separation from the Lord to living with God forever, right? That's not how you get there. It's not love that does that. It's the blood of Jesus that does that. But when you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, when you've asked Him to be the Lord of your life, love happens. That's a result. That is a sign of your salvation. That's how you know that you have gone from death into life, when you are able to love your brother. Especially when they're not behaving the way you think they should. That's a sign of your salvation. Being able to take the persecution of the world. Take the persecution of those that are going to dislike you, that are going to hate you, that are going to treat you bad. Your evidence of salvation is love for the brethren. And if you're always causing strife and backbiting and stirring up arguments and going from this person to this person and saying, well, do you know what that person said about that person? And causing these kind of strifes and everything, and you're okay with it, and you're living in sin, and you're fine with it, and you're not living the way that Jesus wants you to. If you're not loving your brethren, it says that you're abiding in death. That you are willingly and knowingly accepting the fact that you are going to be eternally separated from the Lord. Two clear contrasts. Are you a child of God? Are you a child of the devil? Do you love your brethren? Do you not love your brethren? And not a feeling, not an emotional, yeah, I love them. Well, at least like them. Sacrificial love. Giving of yourself. Showing that love. It's easy to say I love somebody. It's hard to show up sometimes and prove that love. But that's where we are manifested. Verse 15, whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. So for us today, we're sitting here in our society, in our world, this is kind of a leap, right? This kind of seems a little bit of a jump. So how do we go from not liking someone to being a murderer? Seems like a big jump, right? I can dislike somebody and not really want to kill them or not kill them. But this is John reiterating what Jesus had said in Matthew 5:21. Jesus is giving the Sermon on the Mount here, and he says, ye have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. And he goes, I know what you all do. You guys are lawyers. You guys are studiers of the Bible. You guys are the Pharisees. You guys keep everybody in control. And you guys know that old law, right? Thou shalt not kill. And they were proud. They were like, yeah, I never killed anybody. Now, Jesus knew what they were thinking. Jesus knew that if they had the opportunity to kill him and get away with it and nobody get mad at him, why does it say throughout the Bible that these guys didn't attack Jesus? They were afraid of what everybody else was going to do at the time. They were like, well, there's a lot of people that love him. If I could get away with it. But he's like, you've heard it all said, thou shalt not kill. Verse 22, but I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. And whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Once again, Jesus kind of brings it up a notch. You know you shouldn't kill, but what I'm telling you is if you go up to a guy and say, Raca, it's kind of where we don't use it today. I might start using it. Got to find the right context, though. Worthless, you know, attacking them, calling them, you know, worthless to God, worthless in general. If you come up to them, call them a fool, attacking them, and you hate them, that's the same thing as being willing to commit murder in your heart. Because hatred is just a stop on the way to murder. None of this happens overnight, right? You don't just wake up one day and kill somebody. Well, typically. I mean, I guess there are some people, but most of the time, this is a process, right? All of our sin is a process. I mean, the first time you get introduced to something that is sin, you're not like, oh, yeah, I want to. But you keep getting closer and closer to that thing. You start being okay with that thing. You start thinking about it. So it starts out with just a little bit of anger, and it turns into bitterness. And then you don't want to be around them. And then you hate the sight of them. They might not even know anything's going on. And then you start hating them. And you start talking bad about them. And then before you know it, you're full blown, I just wish they'd fall off the face of the earth. It's a step-by-step thing. And that's why it's so important that we as Christians guard our hearts against these things. Guard our hearts against anger and hatred and bitterness and all these things that are easy to take root in your heart and just take you down a road that you just absolutely do not want to go. And what is the answer to it? Love your brethren. Be willing to sacrifice of yourself for their betterment. Be willing to give. What's the most precious commodity we have in this life? Time? How willing are you to give of your time to those around you? I mean, we live in a society where we have all of our earthly needs met for the most part, right? I'll look around and think somebody in here is starving. We're all eating. We've all got shelter. We all have transportation, we got the world's information at our fingertips in our pocket. We're not lacking for things. How sacrificially are you giving of your time for the brethren to make things better in their life? Verse 16, hereby perceive we the love of God because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. So how do we know that God loved us? How do we perceive the love of God? The fact that he sent his son to die on the cross for us. That's how we perceive the love of God. Sacrificial giving. Sacrificial love. God willing to separate himself from his son. Jesus willing to, as a perfect, sinless God, come to this earth as a human being. Can't imagine how disgusting that was for him. Could have been. Did it willingly. Bore all the sins of the world, past, present, and future. So that we, because we messed up and chose sin, because of our bad decisions, sacrificially gave for us. Verse doesn't stop there, does it? That's big. That's important. That's how we perceive the love of God. But compare that to what John's saying. Now, how's the world going to perceive your love? By that same kind of sacrificial love. Now, how does that present itself? Probably nobody's going to have to go out into Winton Road today and save anybody's life. Could happen, but doubtful. Some cases, that would be easier, right? In a lot of ways, it would be easier just to willingly lay down your life in a one-time spur of the moment, jump out in front of the car, kick the other guy out of the way, take the hit. You don't even know what happened. That's just instinctual. That just happens. That's easy to some degree. In some ways, it's a lot more difficult to do what John's talking about. Because this isn't a one-time decision John's talking about. This is like get up every morning and know that today I'm going to give sacrificially to those around me. I'm not going to be hateful, angry, bitter, ugly, backbiting. And I know some of the fathers in this room, and it's probably difficult for the wives. Because we all have tendencies, right? But it's a daily occurrence that we have to go through. Every day we got to give up. Every hour, every minute sometimes, we got to decide. I'm going to love in this situation. I'm going to choose love in this situation. I'm not going to be angry. I'm not going to be bitter. I'm going to live a sacrificial love for those around me. How does it present itself? Sitting down, talking to people that you know are hurting. Calling them on the phone. Maybe even a text message. Snapchat, Instagram, whatever. Talking to people. Reaching out to people. Loving people. And you all know what it looks like. We all have our own, you know, the five love languages that was written. Everyone's got a little bit of a different take on that and how that people accept love and how that people show love. But it's an intentional kind of decision that you have to make. It's not something that happens by accident. It's work. That's why it's love with work boots on. You got to get up every morning. You got to be intentional about it. You have to decide, I am going to choose to follow the Lord and do what He would have me to do today, and that is love my brethren. But whoso, verse 17, whoso hath this world's good and seeth his brother and have not and shutteth up his bowels of compassion for him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? Kind of talked about this one already. Look around and we all have everything we need, right? How in the world can you say that you love people when you have everything that you could possibly ever need, want, and desire, and you're not willing to give to those around you? How can you say that you have the love of God in your heart if you aren't treating others like that? If you're shutting up your bowels of compassion, we would call that the heart today. If you're shutting off your heart to those around you, and you're just, I just don't have time. No, I just don't want to. No, that person annoys me. Oh, that person's a moron. It's not what God wants. Sandy, if you come play a verse of invitation. Verse 18, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Don't have to go into a lot of explanation about this one. We already know what this one means, right? Words mean little. Words mean very, very little. You can say all the right things. We talked about it several weeks ago over and over again, right? You can talk like an angel. But if you don't show up and put on the work boots and show the love of Christ, doesn't mean anything. Don't do it in word or in your tongue what you say, but in deed and in truth. Sometimes love is just being honest with somebody. And that can be just as difficult. But and it's hard to be honest with people sometimes because they don't want to hear what you have to say sometimes. But make sure that you are speaking the love and truth, the truth in love too. And make sure the truth's the truth. Make sure you got some foundation for this truth that you're spouting. Because just because you think it doesn't make its truth, no matter what you hear on the radio or TikTok or whatever else. Don't love in word and in deed. Or don't love in word and in tongue, but love in deed. How you show up. How you work. If everybody stand up, head bowed and eye closed. I have a time of invitation. Take a minute here to reflect on the things that the Holy Spirit has put into your heart today, that has pricked your heart on, that has spurred you on, the things that have caused your heart to realize that you're making, you made some bad decisions, you're doing something wrong. First and foremost, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, if you've never had a time in your life where you've accepted Christ, where you've been saved, that's the first thing you really need to do. God loved you so much. Respond to that. If there are other decisions that you've made that you need to make, you can do that right at your seat where you're standing. You can come down front. Just take time to reflect on what God's laid on your heart. All right. Once again, it's great to see everybody this morning. Great to have a full house here. Make sure you come down and get some pictures taken with the, I won't say ugly ties because maybe you like one of them and I don't want to offend anybody, but the ties. And remember that there is no evening service tonight, so make sure to enjoy time with your family. We'll go ahead and dismiss in a word of prayer. Dear Father, Lord, I thank you for this day once again. I thank you for the time that we could open your word, that we could study your message to us, that we could read your love letter to us that explains the deep and unending love that you have for us, Lord. I just pray that we would respond to that in a real way, that first off that we would accept you as our Savior, Lord, and that we would live a life close to you, Lord, and that as an expression of that love, that we would show love one for the other, that we would be the type of Christian that when we walk out this door, the world sees the light of you in us shining forth, Lord. Just pray that you would help us today to have a good day, Lord, a fellowship and a good time celebrating you and the fathers in our lives, Lord. We love you. We thank you. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.